them, to empower them, and to engage them. Father, we have come. Since Thursday, we were here listening to you through different ministers. And now, Lord, today is the final day, after which we'll be gone back into the world. And all that we have been taught will be tested. And all that we have learned will be proved or proven. Lord, we pray that none of us will be a failure in Jesus' name. Is there anyone, Lord, that is currently here with us? Whether as a member of the church or as a guest of the church, without personal encounter with heaven, without their name in the book of life, Lord God, we pray that today will be a turning point in the life of such a one in Jesus' name. Will ye that were sent unto you now, take charge and take control. Qualify us for heaven. In Jesus' name we pray. We welcome you all to the worship service today in Jesus' name. Actually, today is going to be a combination of both worship service as well as the finality of the convention that started since Thursday. And we thank the Lord for all the various people that God has used in different and diverse ways. And I pray that the hands of God will be strong and mighty upon our lives more and more in Jesus' name. At this moment, we're looking at the message, Qualifications for Heavenly Citizenship. Qualifications for Heavenly Citizenship. And as we look at this passage, you want to ask yourself, why do you come to church of all places? Why don't you go to other religious places? Why don't you spend your time watching television? Why don't you go to film houses? You have chosen to come to church because you want to be taught of the Lord. You have chosen to come to church because you want a better life. You have chosen to come to church because you have come to a realization that there is a place called heaven. And God will take you there in Jesus' name. We are looking at the book of Psalm 15. Here we see a pertinent question. Very, very important for each and every one of us to consider. Looking into the consideration of heaven. Looking unto the concern for heaven. Looking into the qualification for heaven. The psalmist, in particular, was a man that was given to prayer. The psalmist was a warrior. He was a king. He was a shepherd, the shepherd of Israel. He was a man that walked with God. He was a man that knew the mind of God. He was a man that God refers to as a man after my own heart. So he wasn't a stranger to God. He was a man that has been through the ups and the downs of life. He was a man that knew what it means to abound and how to abase. He was a man that has been beaten but gotten up again. And yet, he got to a point in his life, having gotten to the zenith of authority and power, he got to a point in his life, knowing fully well that whatsoever role he had on earth, whatsoever qualification or position he had on earth, will one day come to an end. He knew there is a place called eternity. He knew there is a place after death. And he knew that he couldn't have been anything without the God of heaven. And he knew that God dwells in heaven. He knew heaven is a holy place. He knew God is a holy God. And he was thinking of making it to that eternity at the end of the day. And so he came to himself. Having ruled others, having instructed and directed others, having seen all the challenges of life, he came to himself, and then face to face with God in the spirit realm, he questioned, Lord, who shall abide in thy tabernacle. Psalm 15 from verse 1. Who shall dwell in thy holy hill? And then, the Lord knowing the heartbeat of David, the Lord knowing the concern of David, the Lord knowing the passion and the desire of David, the Lord knowing what he craved for the most, the answer came from the very next verse. And that is why today, if you will heartily, passionately seek the Lord, you will find him. I said you will find him. The Lord answered, he that walketh uprightly and walketh righteousness and speaketh the truth in his heart, he that backbiteth not with his tongue, nor doeth evil to his neighbor, nor taketh up a reproach against his neighbor. He says, in whose eyes a vile person is contemned, but he honoreth them that fear the Lord. He that sweareth to his own heart and changeth not, he that putteth not out his money to usury, nor taketh reward against the innocent, he that doeth these things shall never be moved. David asked one question. He got a myriad of answers. That listen, David, in order to get to heaven, in order to qualify for heaven, listen, David, when you go to the schools of the world, and then you scored 90-95% from the examination, you got A. You are very good. They say you are excellent. David, listen to me. In order to get to my kingdom, you must score 100%. And so God told David that obeying one part of the law and disobeying another part of the law will not qualify you for heaven. I'm good in this, I'm good in that, but the only thing is, I see the lies will not qualify you for heaven. The only thing is, I still support, I don't do it myself, but those that are doing some evil thing, some bad thing, well, because that is the way they feel. I have no condemnation for them, and the best I can do is to give them my support. You will not enter heaven. The Lord is saying, it's not just what people could see in you. God is saying, listen, David, man may be able to judge the outward part of what you do, but I, the living God, I judge the heart of man. And that's why he told David that he that speaketh the truth, where? In his heart. Man may not know why you did what you did. Man may not know the motive, the reason, the intention behind all of your action. But he says, David, I judge everything. I judge every move. I judge every intention. I judge every motive. What man may not see, I see it all. David, are you ready for heaven? And God is talking to you as David today. That if you really want to make it to heaven, be prepared. Heaven is waiting for you, and you will make it. What people do not understand is that everything that is physical, everything that is visible, they are all temporary. They will soon be gone. The things that charms us, the things that gets our attention, the things that distracts us, the things that disconnects us from God, the things that deter us from the way of heaven, they are all temporary things. And God is saying, children, look up unto your father Abraham. Concentrate on heaven. If ye then be risen up with Christ Jesus, seek those things which are above. The things that are invisible. The praise of man is temporary. The wealth of life is temporary. Listen to this. Position and title are all temporary. I am a pastor, temporary. I am an overseer, temporary. As a matter of fact, the more position you get, the more title you get, the more power you get, pay attention, the more difficult it will be for you to make heaven. Are you ready for heaven? God is telling you that the road to heaven is a very narrow one. But in the name of the Lord, you will walk it. By the power of God, you will walk it. And so, let no position get into your head. Let no title get into your head. Activity will end here on earth. At the end of the day, you will be judged on the basis of holiness, on the basis of purity, on the basis of uprightness, on the basis of what you have done with the truth that you have known. Everything temporary will come to an end. 2 Peter chapter 3 tells us, looking at it from verse 12, it says, looking for and hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, brethren, beloved saints, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye be found of him in peace, without spot, and everybody, blameless, blameless, blameless. Listen, some people, you blame them for their wrong, they get mad. You wait until God deals with you. God is saying, you should be without spot. Spot is something that, you say you're wearing white garment. And then, even though the rest, 99.9% of the garment is still white, sparkling white, but there is a little dot in it. It may be a little black thing. It may be a little red thing. It may be a little blue thing on that garment. Although it is small, tiny and minute, the Lord is saying, that is a spot, and that small thing is big enough to deprive you of heaven. So now we see that it's not just about coming together, gathering together, singing together, shouting together, fellowshipping together. It's all about holiness. Somebody say holiness. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. So then, qualifying for heaven demands serious preparation from all heaven-bound pilgrims. Because heaven remains the final home of the redeemed of the Lord. Heaven remains the final resting place of the pure and the holy. God will make you holy. Making it home at last must be the driven passion and pursuit of everyone that is called children of God. Look at this. 2 Peter 3, verses 12 to 14 again. It says, looking for and hasten unto the coming of the day of God. That verse is looking for. Mark that word. Wherein heaven's being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall meet with fervent heat. Verse 13. Nevertheless, we, according to his promise, what's the next word? Look for. Verse 12. Looking for. Verse 13. Look for new heavens and a new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Wherefore, verse 14 now, beloved, see that ye look for such things. Be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. Three times we see that word, look for, expecting. Not only that, desiring, preparing, getting ready for the coming of the Lord. Are we really ready? Gone were the days in the 70s and the 80s. When people were so much in readiness for the coming of the Lord, that it was like a daily expectation. You want to go to school, you'll be thinking, Supposing Christ comes before I finish the school. You want to do anything. Supposing Christ comes before I'm done with that. And so, heaven was small before us. And I am praying the same experience will come upon us again in Jesus' name. The virgins that the scripture spoke about in the book of Matthew, 10 of them waiting, expecting the coming of the Lord. 5 were wise, but 5 were not wise. I declare in the name of Jesus, you will be wise. You know, it's like the religious environment of today. We are all Christian. We are all Christian. Listen to this. We are not all Christians. For the fact that you come to church together does not mean we are all Christians. For the fact that we sing together or preach together does not mean we are all Christians. Some are ready, some are not ready. Some are watching, some are not watching. Some are prayerful, some are not prayerful. Some are concerned about position and title. Some are concerned about recognition. Some are concerned about what is in need for me. Some are concerned about glory. The Lord will help us. Everything temporary will be destroyed. Let's look at what the Bible says. I look at point 1. Destruction and dissolution of the earth with fervent heat. Destruction and dissolution of the earth with fervent heat. Look at 2 Peter. That's 2 Peter where we read. Let's look at it. Look at it. Verse 12. Looking for, are we looking? And hasting unto the coming of the day of God, wherein the heavens being on fire shall be dissolved, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat. With fervent heat. Verse 7, it says, but the heavens and the earth, which are now by the same word, are kept in store, reserved unto what? Unto fire against the day of judgment and perdition of who? Ungodly men. Verse 10, but the day of the Lord will come. How? As a thief in the night. In the which the heavens shall pass away with a great noise, and the elements shall melt with fervent heat, the earth also and the works that are therein shall be burnt up. You will not be burnt. Your works will not be burnt. In the name of Jesus. Destruction and dissolution of earth. Psalm 50 verses 3 and 4. Our God shall come. I thought somebody would say amen. Our God shall come and shall not keep silence. A fire shall devour before him, and it shall be very tempestuous round about him. He shall call to the heavens from above, and to the earth that he may judge his people. Judgment day is coming. Anything we do and everything we do, God will judge. But I pray we'll be justified. Psalm 75, looking at it from verse 3. The earth and all the inhabitants thereof are dissolved. I bear up the pillars of it. Selah. I said unto the fools, deal not foolishly. And to the wicked, lift not up the horn. Lift not up your horn on high. Speak not with a stiff neck. Why? Because judgment day is coming. Everything will be dissolved. Everything will be destroyed. Think of any building, no matter how magnificent. Think of any palace. Think of the White House. Think of the mountains. The Lord is saying, everything will dissolve. Human beings will perish like no man's business. Psalm 102, verses 25 and 26. Of old hast thou laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the work of thy hands. He says, they shall perish, but thou shalt endure. Yea, all of them shall wax old like a garment, and a vesture that thou change not. Change them, and they shall be changed. You know, when the writer of the book of Hebrews in the New Testament began to write, He wouldn't finish up writing without making reference to this statement from David in Hebrews chapter 1, verses 10 and 11. There the Bible says, "And thou, Lord, in the beginning hast laid the foundation of the earth, and the heavens are the works of thy hand. They shall perish, but thou remainest, and they all shall wax old as doth a garment." You have confirmation. Thousands of years after David has spoken, the Apostle Paul also reemphasized the same thing in Hebrews. So then, brethren, we need to be watchful. We need to be prayerful. The members of the choir have told us, get on your knees and pray. Please, before you leave this place, if you came to understand that if the rapture should take place right now, you will not make heaven, forget about that friend you wanted to greet. Forget about that family member you wanted to talk with. Forget about that business you need to talk about. Go on your knees and settle your life with God, because it will not be long. The Lord will come. He will come very, very soon, and he will judge the world. The Lord will keep us in Jesus' name. Isaiah chapter 34, verse 4. "And all the hosts of heaven shall be dissolved, and the heavens shall be rolled together as a scroll, and all their hosts shall fall down, and the leaf falleth off from the vine, as the leaf falleth off from the vine, and as a falling fig from the fig tree." From the fig tree. Nahum also went further to tell us in chapter 1, verses 5 and 6, corroborating what Isaiah has said, corroborating what David has said, corroborating what God himself has said. And Nahum went further to say, "The mountains shall quake at him, and the hills melt, and the earth is burned at his presence. Yea, the world and all that dwell therein, who can stand before his indignation? And who can abide in the fierceness of his anger? His fury is poured out like fire, and the rocks are thrown down by him." Where will you spend eternity? When all is over, when you draw your latest breath and there is no more room for repentance, where will you spend eternity? Pay attention. If you were to be told right now that you have only 1 hour more to live on earth, husband, wife, what would be the thought of your heart? Will you be able to declare like Paul the Apostle and say, "I have fought a good fight, I have finished my course, and now I know there awaits me a crown of righteousness"? Or will your life be full of mourning and lamenting and groaning and wondering, "Oh Lord, give me more time"? I pray God will prepare you. I pray God will prepare us, so that none of us will be caught unprepared, in Jesus' name. If men and women in our days knew the present earth and the works that are therein shall be destroyed and dissolved with fire, they would not labor so much for that which will perish, but for that which will endure eternity. If believers really knew and believed that the heavens and the earth, which are now, are kept in store, reserved unto fire, and that the heavens will pass away with a great noise, and the elements therein shall be melted with fervent heat, the earth also, and the works that are therein shall be burnt up, believers will live a better life. They'll be better prepared. And yet, we never can tell when this will be. The question is, are you ready for his coming? The Lord will prepare you. If that be the case, that everything we can see will come to an end one day, that this building as big as it is will come to an end one day, that great nations will come to an end one day, What then should be your desire and my desire? Second point, the desire to dwell in the new heavens and the new earth. Second Peter chapter 3, verse 13. That point two again is the desire to dwell in the new heavens and the new earth. The desire, the passion, the willingness, the readiness, the aspiration to dwell in the new heavens and the new earth. Second Peter chapter 3, verse 13. Nevertheless, we, there is a promise for the saints of God. There is a promise for the holy and righteous people. We, according to his promise, look for new heaven and new earth, wherein dwelleth righteousness. Titus also talk about looking, and said in chapter 2 of Titus, verse 13, 2 to 14, he says, looking for that blessed hope, and the glorious appearing of the great God and our Savior Jesus Christ, who gave himself for us, that he might redeem us from all iniquity and purify unto himself a peculiar people, zealous of good works. Zealous of good works. Zealous of good works. Jesus is coming again. We have been redeemed so that we can serve the Lord in holiness and righteousness without fear all the days of our life. Luke chapter 1. Luke chapter 1. I look at it from verse 73. The oath which he swore to our father Abraham, that he will grant unto us that we, being delivered out of the hand of our enemies, might serve him without fear. There is no fear in holiness. Without fear. It says, in holiness, we serve him in holiness. In righteousness, we serve him in righteousness. Before him, all the days of our life. All the days of our life. Listen to this. If you're a child of God, anywhere you go, everywhere you go, the presence of God is there with you. If you really have the Spirit of the Lord, pay attention here. And you're really desiring heaven. All the mundanities of this world that charms others will be nothing to you. All the worldliness in dressing, worldliness in business, worldliness in worship will be nothing to you. Holiness will be your watchword. Holiness will be your prayer. Holiness will be your aspiration every day of your life. Listen to this. It is possible to be in a holiness church and to end up in hell eternally. Because many people in that church will just be counting on, I am a member of this church, the name. I'm a member of that church, the name. And yet, their lives does not. Their actions does not. Their behaviors, their attitude does not glorify God. So it's not enough to be part of the church, the physical church. Do your best to be a member of the invisible church, the church of Christ himself. I tell people that every human being on earth is under the control of one out of two spirits. It doesn't matter what you do. One out of two spirits will be controlling you. It's either you are under the control and the influence of the Spirit of God or the control and the influence of the spirit of the devil. Which one is controlling you? Pride, selfishness, self-centeredness, rebellion, position-seeking, worldliness, immorality. There is always a spirit behind it. But when you look at righteousness, when you look at holiness, when you look at obedience, when you look at love, when you look at gentleness, when you look at forgiveness, when you look at temperance, there is a spirit controlling it. Which one is controlling your life? Whether you're a little child or you're a big person, you're under the control of a spirit. To whomsoever you yield yourself, unto such you are a servant. You'll be a servant of God. I say you'll be a servant of God. And God will keep you in Jesus' name. That's why Paul said to the Philippians. In Philippians chapter 3 verse 20. He said, for our conversation is in heaven. The way we do things should be heavenly. The way we relate with one another should be heavenly. I don't want to talk with this. I don't want to talk with that. There is nothing like that in heaven. You offended me and I can never, never let go. There is nothing like that in heaven. Animosity and jealousy, envy, there is nothing like that in heaven. For our conversation is in heaven. From whence also we look for the Savior, the Lord Jesus Christ, who shall change our vile body, that it may be fashioned like unto his glorious body, according to the working whereby he is able even to subdue all things unto himself. The Lord is coming. He's coming for his own, for the pure church, purified church, purged church, purchased church, prepared church. You'll be a member of that church. Isaiah chapter 65 from verse 17. Isaiah 65 verse 17. For behold, I create new heavens and a new earth. And the former shall not be remembered. Somebody say amen. Nor come into mind. But be ye glad and rejoice forever in that which I create. For behold, I create Jerusalem a rejoicing, and her people shall joy. Joy is coming to your life. And I will rejoice in Jerusalem, and joy in my people. And the voice of weeping shall be no more heard in her, nor the voice of crying. There shall be no more thanks. An infant of this, nor an old man that hath not filled this day. The Lord is saying, as a new person in Christ, your days will be fulfilled. He went further to say, for the child shall die 100 years old, but the sinner being 100 years old shall be accursed. You will not be cursed in Jesus' name. In this kingdom of God, in this fold of Christ, in this family of the redeemed of the Lord, the wolf and the lamb shall feel together. I thought somebody would say amen. Amen. That means in the family of God, whether you came from America, you came from the Caribbean, you came from Africa, or wherever you came from, we are members of the same family now. Somebody say amen. Amen. We walk together. We feed together. We dwell together. Whether you are tall and I'm short, whether I'm fat or you are skinny, makes no difference. It's all about the Spirit controlling us. Amen? And we see eye to eye, and the Lord will keep us. Verse 25 says, the wolf and the lamb shall feed together, and the lion shall eat straw like the bullock, and thus shall be the serpent's meat. They shall not cut nor destroy in all my holy mountain, saith the Lord. Amen? 66 verse 22 of Isaiah. For as the new heavens and the new earth, which I will make, shall remain before me, saith the Lord, so shall your seed and your name remain. The Lord is saying, your remembrance will never be forgotten. In the name of Jesus. Hebrews chapter 11, verse 13. Hebrews 11, 13. These all died in faith, not having received the promise, but having seen them afar off, and were persuaded of them, and embraced them, and confessed that they were strangers and pilgrims on the earth. For they that say such things declare plainly that they seek a country. And truly, if they had been mindful of that country from whence they came out, they might have had opportunity to have returned. But now, somebody say now, They desire, that's the word, desire, a better country, a better family, a better relationship, a better company that is an heavenly. Wherefore, God is not ashamed to be called their God, for he hath prepared for them a city. A city. A city. And God wants you to be a member of that city. And it will keep you to the very end in Jesus' name. Sodom and Gomorrah. Babylon and Jerusalem were all taken by surprise despite the warnings from God. This time and age, many in the church and myriads outside of the church would also be taken by surprise despite the warning that is coming unto us. Don't be caught unaware. Watch and pray. I say watch and pray. And the Lord will keep you in Jesus' name. I get to the third point of our message. Diligence to be found in him, unblameable in holiness. That means there is work for you to do. If you really want to make it to heaven, there is work for you to do. There are things you need to give up. There are things you need to change. There are things you need to correct. There are restitutions you need to make. There are repentances you need to do. It's not enough to come to church. It's not enough to be a worker in the church. Ensure that heaven approves you and approves of your service. Diligence to be found in him, unblameable in holiness. 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 14. Wherefore, beloved, seeing that ye look for such things, be diligent that ye may be found of him in peace, without spot and blameless. Without spot and blameless. Examine yourself. Examine your life. Examine your conduct. Examine your character. Examine your behavior. 2 Corinthians 13:5 says, examine yourselves, whether ye be in the faith. Prove your own selves. Know ye not your own selves? How that Jesus Christ is in you, except ye be reprobates. 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verses 7 and 8 says, so that ye come behind in no gift, waiting for the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, who shall also confirm you unto the end, that ye may be blameless in the day of our Lord Jesus Christ. Pay attention here. The Lord is saying that, number one, you must be born again, you must be saved. Number two, with that salvation, you must serve the Lord. There is grace and there is gifts. The combination of grace and gifts will bring about glory. And in your life, God wants to be glorified. Through your life, God wants to be glorified. So then, you can't say, I am born again, and then you are idle. I am born again, I can't walk with this, I can't walk with that. No. It says, you must see that you come behind in no gift. In no gift. Because even that will be judged. So, whatever area of work you are, put in your best into it. Do all the research you can to make it the best it can ever be. And God will help you in Jesus' name. And as you do all of this, Paul said again in Philippians 1:27, that as we work together, as we partner together, as we labor together, he says, only let your conversation be as it becometh the gospel of Christ. That whether I come or see you, or else be absent, I may hear of your affairs, that ye stand fast in one spirit, with one mind, striving together for the faith of the gospel. We'll be united. We'll work together in Jesus' name, so that at the end of the day, our hearts will be knit together unblameably in holiness, in righteousness before God. Jude verse 20 says, but ye beloved, building up yourselves on your most holy faith, praying in the Holy Ghost, keep yourselves in the love of God, looking for the mercy of our Lord Jesus Christ unto eternal life, and of some have compassion, making a difference. Make a difference in somebody's life. And all that save with fear, pulling them out of the fire, hating even the garment spotted by flesh. Now unto him that is able to keep you from falling, and to present you faultless before the presence of his glory with exceeding joy. To the only wise God, our Savior, be glory and majesty, dominion and power, both now and forevermore. Amen. The Lord will keep you. The Lord will preserve you. The Lord will perfect you. The Lord will prosper you. Let's go before the Lord in prayer. Without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. That means you have to abstain from all appearances of evil. All those worldly dressing, give them all. Worldly companion, give them all. Worldly language, give them all. Ungodly business, give them all. Abstain from all appearances of evil. And then the very God of peace will sanctify you wholly. You want to make heaven? Follow peace with all men. Follow peace with all men. Because without holiness, no man shall see the Lord. No man shall see the Lord. No man shall see the Lord. Commit yourself to the hand of the Lord. Positions are good. Titles are wonderful. But heaven is better. Heaven is better. Eternity, eternity. Where will you spend eternity? Except a man be born again, he cannot see the kingdom of heaven. He cannot see. He will not see the kingdom of heaven. God is calling you to this new life, to this holy life, to this righteous life, to this pure life. To this pure life. After coming for this convention, should the rapture take place? Or death, where will you spend eternity? No movement at this point. I expect Edward to be praying at this point. Where will you spend eternity? Qualification for heavenly citizenship. For heavenly citizenship. In Jesus' name we pray. Ushers at the door. Nobody come in anymore. Nobody go out. No movements. Be seated. All eyes closed. All eyes closed. God is serious about his kingdom. God cannot be mocked. The soul that sinneth, it shall die. If a righteous man will turn away from his righteousness and commit iniquity, and he dies in that iniquity, all his righteousness which he had done will be forgotten. And the sin in which he's now found, will he be judged. And all through eternity, he will lament in hellfire. Please, all eyes closed. There is obedience in holiness. There is humility in holiness. Let not your position hinder you. Right now, on this last day, before you leave this hall of meeting, you want to settle your account with the Lord And you want to say, Lord Jesus, here am I. I repent of all my fault and all my wrongs. I submit and surrender. If you raise up your hand, heaven is waiting for you. Heaven is waiting for you. Forget your position, forget your title. Heaven will receive you. Raise it very well. Those of you that are putting it halfway, you are not raising it for man. God bless you. God bless you. God bless you. Are there other people? Heaven is waiting for you. Those of you with your hands up, please lay it upon your chest. Lay it upon your chest and quietly talk to God. Confess your sin. Confess your fault. Tell him you are sorry. Tell him to wash you clean. Tell him to make you whole. In Jesus' name we pray. Father, I pray for these ones, old and young, that have indicated that they want to make right their ways and be better prepared for heaven. Father, look down from heaven. Wash away their sins. Forgive their iniquity. Wash them with the blood of Jesus. Receive them unto your own self and qualify them for your kingdom. For every one of us that are here, Lord, we pray that you prepare us for glory. We pray that none of us will miss heaven at last in Jesus' name. Thank you, Father, for answering. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Thank you so much.